Good evening. My name is Sean Hudgenwardle, and I will be your moderator for this evening's class. Welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school, and it is not a church. Neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh our Elohim and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity to this present day. This school was established as the result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year of 1931. We were incorporated in the state of California in 1958. Since then, we've established various branch schools throughout the United States and in various foreign countries. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. In this school, we use the true, correct, and original name and title of the Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit, as contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name of our Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title of the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit, manifested in or out of a physical body, is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles. They are not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8:5 that there are lords many and gods many. But we now know that each Lord must have a name, and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that neither the Hebrew, Greek, nor Latin languages have any letters or characters in their alphabet that would produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1,400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and original name of our Father and his Son. Christ is a title, just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state he is incomprehensible and inscrutable. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh in his pure spirit state symbolized on this chart as a fiery cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We have this cloud drawn all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Now Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a superincorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without having flesh and blood. This shape and form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this self-same spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world erroneously calls Jesus Christ. Now there is only one name given unto salvation, and we all must know this name. So the simple yet intelligent question that we should ask ourselves is, What was the name of the Savior during the time that he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, he instructed Moses to come atop of Mount Sinai, where he showed him a tabernacle pattern in a vision. He instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This tabernacle consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. In this school, we show proof that everything is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. The 10 primary constitutional aims and objectives of the Institute are as follows. First is to help you find and know Yahweh, our Elohim, as he really is and actually exists. Second is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law or so-called law of nature and the powers latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religion, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith which was once delivered to the sons or children of Yahweh. Ninth is to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained that there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace. Our slogan is speak the truth. Today, we will have a prayer by Dr. Bud Wunsch, and that will be followed by a selection of music. Our scripture lesson will be the sixth chapter of Deuteronomy, and that will be read by Dr. Nanette Ramirez.
Sometimes it's called being fed. We do thank you for those that you have brought here, and may we all be doing things that are pleasing in your sight, Yahweh. These thanks and requests we ask in the name of thy only begotten Son, Yahshua the Messiah. Let's all say hallelujah. Thank you.
Saved in my heart. Good evening, class. I'll be reading out of the Holy Name Bible containing the Holy Name version of the Old and New Testaments, critically comparing with ancient authorities and various manuscripts, revised by the late A.B. Trina, the Scripture Research Association. I'll be reading Deuteronomy 6 chapter. Now these are the commandments, the statutes, and the judgments which Yahweh, your Elohim, commanded to teach you, that ye might do in the land whither ye go to possess it, that thou mightest fear Yahweh thy Elohim to keep all his statutes and his commandments, which I command thee, thou and thy son's son, and all the days of thy life, and that thy days may be prolonged. Hear therefore, O Israel, and observe to do it, that it may be well with thee, and that ye may increase mightily, as Yahweh Elohim of thy fathers hath promised thee, in the land that floweth with milk and honey. Hear, O Israel, Yahweh our Elohim is Yahweh a unity, and thou shalt love Yahweh thy Elohim with all thine heart, and with all thine soul, and with all thy might. And these words which I command thee this day shall be in thine heart, and thou shalt teach them diligently unto thy children, and shalt talk to them when thou sittest in thine house, and when thou walkest by the way, and when thou liest down, and when thou risest up. And thou shalt bind them for a sign upon thine hand, and they shall be as frontlets between thine eyes, and thou shalt write them upon the post of thy house and on thy gates. And it shall be when Yahweh thy Elohim shall have brought thee into the land which he sware unto thy fathers, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob, to give thee great and goodly cities, which thou buildest not, and houses full of all good things which thou fillest not, and wells digged which thou diggest not, vineyards and olive trees which thou plantest not. When thou shalt have eaten and be full, then beware lest thou forget Yahweh, which brought thee forth out of the land of Egypt, from the house of bondage. Thou shalt fear Yahweh thy Elohim, and serve him, and shalt swear by his name. Ye shall not go after the idols of the people which are round about you. For Yahweh thy Elohim is a jealous El among you, lest the anger of Yahweh thy Elohim be kindled against thee, and destroy thee from off the face of the earth. Ye shall not tempt Yahweh your Elohim as ye tempted him in Massa. Ye shall diligently keep the commandments of Yahweh your El, and his testimonies, and his statutes which he hath commanded thee. And thou shalt do that which is right and good in the sight of Yahweh, that is, that it may be well with thee, and that thou mayest go in and possess the good lands which Yahweh sware unto thy fathers, to cast out all thine enemies from before thee, as Yahweh hath spoken. And when thy son asketh thee in time to come, saying, what mean the testimonies and the statutes and the judgments which Yahweh our Elohim hath commanded you? Then thou shalt say unto thy son, where were Pharaoh's bondmen in Egypt? And Yahweh brought us out of Egypt with a mighty hand. And Yahweh showed signs and wonders great and sore upon Egypt, upon Pharaoh, and upon all his household before our eyes. And he brought us out from thence, that he might bring us in, to give us the land which he sware unto our fathers. And Yahweh commanded us to do all these statutes, to fear Yahweh our Elohim for our good always, that he might preserve us alive, as it is at this day. And it shall be our righteousness if we observe to do all these commandments before Yahweh, our Elohim, as he hath commanded us. I have read Deuteronomy, the sixth chapter. Let us all say hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Wunsch. Apologize for the mic issues, and thank you, Dr. Ramirez. So today is Thursday, and it is our open testimony night. So I would like to open up this floor, but before I do that, I'd like to welcome back our dean, Dr. Marlon Love, who is traveling. He went to the gathering that they had in North Carolina, and can't wait to hear, you know, the report back from that. But before we do so, we're just going to go along and ask if anybody has any testimonies today, and we'll open up the floor here and on Zoom if there's anybody out there to give a testimony. Anybody? Okay. So for our first speaker, it's going to be the Dean of the Ontario Branch, Dr. Marlon Love. Dr. Love?
Yeah. Well, good evening, class. It's indeed a pleasure to be back in sunny California. having traveled last week to Charlotte, North Carolina, whereby the Zoom class there in Charlotte, North Carolina, held a gathering, which I feel went off without a hitch. It was smooth as honey. It was a beautiful thing after the first gathering, after the year-long pandemic, if you would, whereby brothers from all over the country came, and even Canada came down in order to support, in order to gather, in order to sup with all those that were in attendance, whether on the floor or off the floor. It mattered not. I was very involved with helping the brother in there with the technology in order to put the flyers and the organization of the registration and just to make things simpler from an electronic standpoint, if you would. And that was really received and appreciated. There were other brethren that came with audio and video. Brethren came with charts whereby they were able to splice them together, and we had a beautiful stage presence with those charts, whereas, you know, we all can watch them. I think it was on the archetype pattern workshop. Will Williams, of course, had his handy dandy phone out and was live streaming. Tina Pettigrew had the beautiful cameras whereby we hope that she'll be, when time permits, she'll splice it all together and there'll be one whole class, if you would. I don't know how many hours that might be, but she'll be able to splice it all together, whereas you'll have one running 2 hours or 3 hours or however long it was, of the speakers and of the picture gathering that we all had at one time. And like I say, it was just a beautiful event whereby on Thursday night we had a open testimony, whereas we just had finger foods and people were able to come that came early on Thursday night. I arrived there Thursday morning, was able to walk around and get a nap in before the 5 o'clock event, and it ran for about 2 hours. People that came in was able to stand up and give a testimony. Will also has that on video as well on Facebook on his page. And so various people got up and gave a testimony how they came into class and what they look forward to and whatnot. So that was good. And then Friday evening, they had one class because they had set everything up with the charts and stuff. And, you know, brethren that seen each other before, but then happy to be together again, to work together, to construct the charts and hang the charts and going to get various tools and whatnot in order to hang them and maintain the charts on the floor was always good. The hotel was at our beck and call for the most part, and we had a full house. I forget the number. I think it was like 140 registered at the hotel. And then at any odd times, there was over 100 people in attendance during the class lectures from Friday to Sunday. Mm-hmm. It kind of dwindled up and down. But I think the biggest thing, too, also of the event, was the number of visitors, first-time visitors, and returning visitors that came. I think that was one of the highlights, if there was a highlight, that new people that the brethren there in North Carolina had spoken to in order to encourage them to come, because initially it was called it a gathering because initially it was only going to be a few people, those that were in Charlotte, North Carolina, and I guess there is a fashion of them that are of the progressive doctrine, if you would. Mm-hmm. And nonetheless, they were going to just gather together in the hotel. And Katonia Parks, who was kind of spearheading the class there, didn't think of 140 people initially, you know. So as things began to build, that's when I said, well, you need a little help, because they were just going to do it off of paper of the people that were going to register to come, and that would be sufficient. But then when people say, hey, I'm coming, I want to come, it's like, whoa, how are we going to maintain that? So that's why I jumped in and helped to solidify some kind of orderliness to the registration and kind of get an idea, hey, how's this thing growing? And it grew to 140 people. Where even I heard today that the hotel was pleasantly surprised that we had that many people in attendance and acted accordingly, you know. Yeah. And they were very happy with that. And even so much so, I believe that there's talk that Charlotte, North Carolina may be able to hold a class there at the venue there at the Hilton, you know, once a week or some fashion, sometime they'll have to work out the details. But that sprung out of it, whereby the hotel was happy to talk with them to see if they can commandeer a place with inside the hotel, which is a beautiful hotel. If you saw the pictures right there on the lake. Mm-hmm. They're at the University of, I believe it was University of North Carolina, Charlotte. And that's the little courtyard where they have, that's on the backside of the campus. And so with that, it was wonderful that they took to us, and it was nice. We had a transportation individual that was able to shuttle certain of the brethren from the airport to the hotel that was on call for us, so we had transportation, if you would. And again, the brethren there had already reached out to those people that they knew, and many of them came, you know, whether they were returning visitors, they had been in class or had not been in class for a number of years, came and listened to the gospel preached all 3 days. So I think that was a big highlight, having the visitors that were shown up, and even people off the hotel were given leaflets in order to encourage them to come and listen if they had time. So they didn't have to sign their name necessarily. So we didn't get all the visitors that even signed the name, mm-hmm. that people came in and was able to hear the gospel preached. So it was those things that were very encouraging. Now, this was my fourth convention of sorts or symposium. And every time you get stronger and you get to know your brethren, as it were, you know, from the first time that I showed up in 2017, I think it was, in Florida, and until now. And you grow, and as you understand, as we begin to understand, even as we use this mosaic chart, which we say takes our picture, when the person first comes in, they may look at this chart and consider it, as Dr. Gross says, scrambled eggs at first view. You know, we can kind of gather out of all the charts. I think this chart is the most visually, this image There's only one thing that's most from afar recognizable. You know, you may see Noah's Ark on here, you know, from afar, but until you get up and actually see what has been depicted on this chart, you don't know what's on the chart. Unless you get eyeball to the charts and see, not from your seat, but up close and personal. You can't see into what is depicted on this chart and understand how this chart, as it would be said, takes your picture, but how? And we're able to go through the scriptures by way of Dr. Kennedy having a divine vision and revelation, as is explained in the moderation, how this takes our picture and understanding how to bring it down into a concise, orderly, and methodic pattern whereby a person can begin to understand what it is that we preach. So the every session, there was three sessions, five sessions in all. I think it was one on Friday, the late session. We had three speaker format. Saturday, we had a three speaker format from starting at 11 to 1. And then there was a break. And then we came back again at 6 until 9, I believe. Something of that nature. The second evening on Saturday, it was a question answer. So we had two speakers speak on Saturday evening. And then the third speaker, you would, or the third portion of it was question and answer, whereby we allowed the new visitors, and there were some new visitors there as well. Yes, Bud.
Was there anyone representing International Headquarters?
International Headquarters, not a representative per se, no. It wasn't a thing whereby it was really, I don't think, put out there that way, because it was a Zoom class of Charlotte, North Carolina, and they're not a branch of the IDMR, and so therefore there was no need to shake the nest, if you can say it that way. And the brothers came together in support of that class. That's are striving together in order to formulate a class whereby they can teach the gospel. Since there's someone from Springfield who had previously moved down there, and that was the Petro that got the thing started, because the gospel, where like she had to move, wasn't there. And therefore, in her heart, she took it upon herself in order to muster together what was held as the fruits of the Spirit gathering. Yes, sir.
Was your dad there?
No, my dad did not make it. My dad didn't. It was kind of a last minute, because they only did it in 3 months. So you imagine most seminars put together of that magnitude. It takes quite a bit of time to formulate the rooms and the hotel and the charts and whatnot. And them being a small class, they don't even have a live class. They have Zoom. Mm-hmm. So they've been doing Zoom, I think, maybe past 6 months or so, maybe a year. You know, I think in the moderation it says that they started in 2020. So sometime during 2020, when they got established, I think October or such, they got established. So not even a full year of them giving classes on Zoom. So they didn't have the charts, physical charts they don't have. They don't have anything. You know, they don't even have everything we had that you see there was all bought that weekend that Friday, in order to set everything up. The bell is brand new. The pointer was brand new. So all that was ushered in order to help facilitate the things that, you know, they did not have, and the brothers all pitched in to got those things for them. I think Frank Lewis and certain other brothers brought down the charts that was the necessity to have. We had the 40 plate chart there in twofold fashion, and so that was all gathered. That was Saturday night. And again, brothers hung out afterwards. We ate at the bar/restaurant that was there, and people just mingled and able to, in the course quarters, and most everybody stayed at that hotel. Some few people stayed at a close by walking distance, a hotel where the Hyatt Regency or whatever it was. So everybody was, you know, within the building, so it made it easy, whereas we didn't have to commute anywhere. And that was Saturday. And then Sunday, we had a class start at 10:30 until 1. And again, there was a three-speaker format there as well. And again, on Facebook, you have it. And pretty soon on YouTube, for those who don't have Facebook, can view all the lectures. And again, the seminar or the gathering was about what is the New Testament. So we have the pamphlet that was given to everybody in their packet. I think there was a magnet thing for the refrigerator, speaking about the New Testament that people could hang on their refrigerator, magnetic magnet, the flyer, and pen, of course, and the schedule. And then the everybody got a pamphlet. And so that was the theme, this ninth chapter of Hebrews, and then the theme being, what is the New Testament? So a lot of the speakers were speaking in various fashions. And we're all, we say we sup. And when we eat, there's a lot of different kind of foods we can eat.
Right.
You understand? And, and us being epistles written of the Holy Spirit, we all have our characteristics, if you would. We're all various kind of meals in how we speak and how we authenticate the gospel in various ways. So from the males and females that spoke in the characters of the different teachers that were teaching, there was plenty to eat for everybody in various fashions, you know. And one of the speakers made mention that, you know, we're not here to come and listen to our favorite speaker. As far as an individual goes, we come to listen to what thus saith Yahshua the Messiah through a vessel. Now, some are very animated. Some are very high energy, mm-hmm. You know. Frank Lewis being one, very dogmatic. There's others that are more subtle. I was able to speak. I spoke on a Saturday morning session. I was the first speaker, so I attempted to lay a foundation in order to the following speakers to springboard off of, and they sprung right away. You know, there was no holding back, if I can say that. Even with the new people, you know, I was commended for going slow in how I speak. My first time at a large convention, I think it was really the first time I spoke to more than 100 people at any one time, you know. So that was a learning curve for me. I've been speaking here, so I got pretty used to the public speaking aspect of it, you know. And a lot of people that have seen me, I didn't know who they were, but they've listened to me, and so they were aware of me. So I was very, very gracious and humbled to meet a lot of people that are on Zoom or YouTube that watches us in class, and they give us and give their love for us for being on and being diligent as we have been, you know, all through the pandemic. You realize that we stayed open throughout the entire pandemic. We didn't get Zoom until they pretty much claimed the pandemic was over in some fashion or another, when we deemed to get Zoom, right? So it wasn't that the pandemic made us get Zoom because we weren't gathering together. We did it out of the expediency of a better delivery, if you would, and to cut down any riffraff that came through YouTube. Mm-hmm. So, the questions and comments on YouTube, we couldn't control them. So without that being a hindrance and a distraction to people, we went to Zoom, whereby they can come in and ask their questions, but you notice they don't come in and ask their questions now that they're off the,
right.
We cut the back seat quarterbacks out, if you would. And we still have it open and available, but they didn't come. So there was a distraction there, ultimately. So but yet everybody can still watch it on Zoom after an hour or so after class, and they still get the same effect, right? Mm-hmm. So that's why we went to Zoom, if you didn't know.
I heard you did a good job.
Is that?
I heard you did a good job.
Oh.
Yeah, on Saturday.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And again, like I said, people were very humble and appreciative of what all the speakers had said. So we endeavor to express the what the New Testament is. And I think even for new people, and a lot of new people I heard to Katonia, who was kind of spearheading the class down there. They reached out to her, say, when can we come again? Mm-hmm. So when you hear that from new people, it's very encouraging, even though she's known them for some time. But yet certain ones, I know a close family, or a friend of the families came and jumped right in, started reading the scriptures, had been in or had been out for a number of years, but had come back and jumped right in and made mention to her that he was happy to have this event to see that we're not progressive, if you would, right? And that we spoke the gospel as he once learned it and was very encouraged by us being open in order to allow him to come and participate.
Okay. Can you explain what the term progressive means in IDMR or in our class?
Real simple. Is Henry Clifford Kenny your savior?
That's not what he said.
That's the progressive. When you say that Henry Clifford Kenny is your savior, that's progressive.
Thank you.
So in a nutshell.
So-called.
Excuse me? That's so-called. Call it another camp, if you would. It's been deemed other doctrine, if you would. It's not the doctrine that he brought in, that I was taught, and it's not the doctrine that was taught this past weekend. Mm-hmm. So call it progressive, and it's not progressive. You know, call this, and call it black and white. You went beyond in some imaginary form and thinking that this is a black and white character and thinking it's just a character and not having any reverence to Elohim, a super incorporeal being without shape and form. Anything otherwise is an imagination of one's own interpretation of what we've been taught. It's not the true gospel.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
They are progressive, but they're progressing on the wrong road.
Yeah, I mean, there's only one way, as Sean talked about it on Tuesday night, right? There's only the way, the truth, and the life. And no man comes unto the Father yet by Yahshua. And if you think that it's going to be by a man named Henry Clifford Kinney, you're off track. Correct. Right? That's what that would mean. And so you have a batch of people throughout the country that have a sprinkling of false information, if you would. And it's that false information that we preach against, if you would, without the lack of a better term. And so I don't know, few might have slipped in. I don't know everybody from that part of the country, so I'm not privy as to who's who. Not my problem, specifically, other than to give a good report as well as I can give it and listen to those that resonate, because it is a resonation, a resonating gospel.
Yes.
I think the feet of them that preach the gospel, can you find that, search that? How beautiful the feet. I think it's Romans, 10th chapter. If you can find that for me.
It is
10:15. 10:15. I was close. So if you go up, maybe go up a little bit, catch the continuity of what, and I love this, that verse, because as I said, it resonates with a person when they hear Yahweh, Elohim, and Yahshua on the ride home from my stay after the gathering, which ended on Sunday. My wife and I drove down to South Carolina, to Myrtle Beach, and we hung out there. Rented a car and drove there about 3 hours away. We reside, we stay there, turn the car in, and we stay the next two days there at Myrtle Beach, had a good time, got to swim in the Atlantic Ocean for the first time. So a lot of firsts for me that way. Got to see the churches down in the Bible Belt. I didn't realize that was Billy Graham's area. So the guy that was kind of our caretaker as far as transporting us from the airport to the hotel and whatnot, you know, he was filling me in on the Bible Belt issues and stuff. And so I was familiar with the Bible, but I didn't know it was that high. I thought it was more Alabama, Tennessee, but Billy Graham, that was his country. That's where they started out. And, you know, the revival, there was one place they had a tent out right by the church. There was nobody out there, but I was going to pull over and stop, but I just kept on moving. My wife was like, let's not stop because we don't know, you know, what kind of energy might be out there or whatever. But nonetheless, it was fun for me to see so many churches. We say it on every corner in L.A., but they had it out and they were out in the fields, and they were, you know, they were clean. Just amazing how many that there were, though. But nonetheless, on the way from the hotel there in South Carolina to the airport that day, our Uber driver asked what we were doing in South Carolina. So I said that, you know, I've come to give a lecture and to speak on the metaphysics of our Creator and how it relates to our livelihood and whatnot. And the lady was very animated. Oh, and there's swerve. I said, hey, it's okay.
Really?
Keep driving. She was excited. Like, I really listened to, Tony Robbins, motivational speakers and things of that nature. And I said, well, we're not quite along that lines, but we use your Bible in order to break it down to explain certain things. And she asked me, like what? So I just ran down the names real quick about Lord and God and about, you know, her name was Cheyenne or something. I don't say the Cheyenne, right? I don't put the in front of a proper name. I said, but you calling him the Lord and your Jesus that people cry out to. She wasn't really religious as far as I could tell, but, you know, she knew Jesus. And I said how Jesus was an erroneous name, and I kind of broke it down in a fast way. And she said, wow, I never heard of that before. You know, so there's a lot of people all over the country that have an inkling of something that's not just right, you know. And when you lay things out in such a dogmatic way and kind of line things up, well, I want to know more. So I was able to give her my website and whatnot and hope she, because you can interact with me through there.
Right.
So I told her I'll remember her name if she interacts. But that's happened all the time. I went out on every trip I've been on thus far. I have a person in Argentina that I still communicate with that's in Argentina that understands how there's no J, understands that Lord is a title and God is a title, and understands in Proverbs 30 and 4 that what is his name and what is his son's name, if thou canst tell. And so when I spoke to her about that, 3-4 years ago, my first convention in Florida, she's been calling me ever since. Now, it's not fluid because I don't speak Spanish and we use translator, but she has some inkling and invited me to come to Argentina at some point. You know, so as we speak to people and share with new people, they resonate with the gospel. And as we begin to preach the gospel, as it says here with Saul, read.
Romans 10 and 10, mm-hmm. Just start at 10. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness.
With the heart. And we say every time the prayer or something, open up your heart and open up your mind, whereby the spirit may commune with spirit. Because you have a light, right? John 1 and 4 says, this is the light that lighteth every man, right? And in order to have that light, we preached the law and the prophets, because if you don't speak according to the law and prophets, there's no understanding or no light in the individual. Now, we are saying that we understand the gospel of Yahshua Messiah by his death, burial, and resurrection. And according to the scriptures, we'll preach that. There's some light that's going to resonate with that you just read. Read.
And with the mouth confession is made unto salvation.
Mm-hmm.
For the scripture saith, whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed.
For the scripture saith, not the Bible, but the scripture saith. Mm-hmm. That's what's speaking, because that's what spoke through the prophets, correct? That's who spoke to Moses at the burning bush. That's who spoke to Moses up here in the mount. It's the Spirit that spoke those things, and it's by the Spirit. Keep it on the, just keep it on the Romans there for me. It's the it's the scripture that saith, is what I'm saying. Read.
For there is no difference between the Jew and the Greek.
We know that now, but back then, when they were dealing with this Mosaic chart and dealing with Moses, there was a difference. Mm-hmm. There was the nation of Israel, and then there was the Gentiles, if you would, right? But now there's no longer a difference, as we say in our aims, in the second aim, right? The universal brotherhood. How's it say? To form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah without distinction of race. That take away the Greeks and the Romans, the Indians, the Mexicans, the Asians. They take away all of that.
Yep.
Read.
For there is no difference between the Jew and the Greek, for the same Elohim over all is rich unto all that call upon him.
Mm-hmm. You got to call upon him. Got to seek after him while he yet may be found, as their speakers speaking the true gospel. Because as we found out, over time, it can be lost. And a new interpretation, a progressive thinking, you know, progressive in thinking, well, I'm not going to need blood, water, spirit, 40.
Yeah.
I'm not going to need Moses. I'm not going to need that Bible, because that's what's being said. That's progressive. You've gone beyond what you was given. That's a wrong way of progressiveness, if you would, right?
Degressing.
What did you say? Degressive.
Transgressive.
Or regression. Yeah. I don't know how you, regression is almost good, right? So that's what we can lose. Keep reading.
For whosoever shall call upon the name of Yahweh shall be delivered.
Now, if you're going to live your Bible, and everybody got one, or can find one, and you read that fourth verse, or that 13th verse, calling on the name of the Lord, don't work. Don't work at all. You're stuck like a duck. Mm-hmm. If you're gonna believe what Saul talking about, and that's in your so-called new Bible
yeah.
portion of your Bible, the New Testament portion, the so-called New Testament portion of your Bible, that's what it says. Calling on the name, read it out of King James. I'm just wanting to just make it real quick and clear. So I'm not, you know, not everybody has the Holy Name Bible. So I just want to make it clear in the King James Bible.
King James.
And there's a whole bunch of other Bibles we can get. It's going to say the same thing. Read.
For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved.
You got a problem with that. I got a problem with that. Many people don't have a problem with that. Because they're transliterated, they're doing something, thinking that this is a name. And that's a problem. That's not what it says. That's not what Saul wrote at all. And that's an error. Keep reading.
How then shall they call on him in whom they have not believed?
They can't do that. They can't call on them. Grab Eunice, grab me Isaiah 28, please. 28. Go ahead and keep reading there, Sean.
And how shall they believe in him of whom they have not heard?
Uh-huh.
And how shall they hear without a preacher?
Uh-huh. This is Saul saying that how are they going to do this when they're going to call on the name of the Lord. How are they going to do it? Right. Read.
And how shall they preach except they be sent, as it is written, how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace and bring the glad tidings of good things.
How are they going to do that? How are they going to hear except they see and resonate to the feet of those that preach the gospel? When they start, we call it running the charts, right? running the death, burial, resurrection, the blood, water, spirit, 40. They huff and puff sometimes. We get excitable. When you get to, you know, some people say slow down, you know. But sometimes when you're on that train of thought and they're coming and you have to have it clear. You resonate, as I said, is why I got to that chapter, that verse, the feet of them that run the gospel, that talk to and preach the gospel. You can see it, you can hear it within your soul. Grab me Isaiah 28. 9 and 10. Mm-hmm. We're going to keep going past there, though.
Whom shall he teach knowledge?
That's what Saul had just said. If you remember what Saul had just said there in the 10th chapter, read.
And whom shall he make to understand doctrine?
Understand this teaching is what he did, because he said he's raising able-bodied ministers to preach. Mm-hmm. And if this is Yahshua in a body that came down in order to divulge the information that you see around this room on these charts in a prescribed fashion,
right,
in order to be taught and learned of them by milk.
Them that are weaned from the milk and drawn from the breast.
Man, it's beautiful, man. When it's weaned from the milk, you have the law and the prophets, male or females, when they have birth and they have that child, they have that breasts, they have two.
Right.
They expel milk in order to give a child sustenance,
right,
in order to grow up. And that milk is indicative of the law and the prophets, because you have to switch them back and forth,
right,
the infant, if you would, mm-hmm, in order to get the nourishment to do what? Read.
For precept must be upon precept.
It's in order to establish precepts upon precepts. Precepts being, anybody have an answer for what a precept is?
A principle.
A principle.
Mm-hmm.
What else? Immutable.
Does not change. Yeah.
Immutable. Mm-hmm. Does not change. Forever ending. Factual.
Perpetual.
It turns over and over. As you have these events that happen down to the period of time, perpetually turning over itself, whereby you can see a bloodline, right? Up on this portion of the chart, and also down here, a principle of a death, correct? All the way down, Stephen. You got James down, James here, Stephen here. You have the Messiah here with the supper, right? Partaking of that lamb is a type, and you have Yahshua the Messiah, being the only begotten of the Father, whereby he was specially prepared body unto death. You got precept in the dictionary?
Precept from Merriam-Webster.
Mm-hmm.
It is a noun. Number one, a command or principle intended especially as a general rule of action.
It's a general rule of action that we're going to pick up a bloodline, a water line, and a spirit line. That's the general rule of action as you read down through your through the events and time of the scriptures that you're looking for: blood, water, spirit. And as you see how these are immutable, they don't change, and they will appear within your through the events of the book, and that's going to give you the witness of the unity of the Yahhead. Precept was good. Is there another one?
Yes, number two, an order issued by legally constituted authority to a subordinate official.
Hey, we are the subordinate officials given authority for spirit law
by the one and only
Spirit Yah of Yahweh, giving us authority by his principles, his precepts, and his purpose, pattern, and plan. That gives us authority to preach the gospel.
Absolutely.
Keep reading out of Isaiah. That's good with precept.
Precept upon precept.
And we build upon building. Just as this child with this law and this prophets build as they suckle, as we learn. And we can't go away from that. You don't ever leave a child typically does not leave their mother or their father. If there's philoprogenesis of love,
right,
in the household. Mm-hmm. as they remain. You're not going to leave the foundations by which we've been taught. Keep reading.
Line upon line, mm-hmm. line upon line.
That's right.
Here a little and there a little.
Yes.
For with stammering lips and another tongue,
see, that's
will
when
I
get,
speak.
That's when the preachers get to jumping around. You start saying, well, where are they at? Where are they? What are they doing? You know, they're not just reading from Genesis to Revelation in a methodical fashion as the Catholics do. They'll pick a chapter or verse and they'll read verbatim what it says and give you their interpretation of how they are reading it. They're not jumping around. They're not stammering in their lips. They're not going by any pattern, known pattern, whereby they're going to give you the pattern whereby you're going to be self-sufficient. See, that's what it happens in the school. When you're in your school, you're not going back to your third grade teacher and asking her how to multiply, asking her how to formulate a sentence. She didn't taught you that. Whereby you can stand on your own 2 feet now and write you a sentence and figure out how much a bill costs after you done purchased some things, right? Yeah, right. You're smart enough to go back to the teller and say, ah, you made a mistake.
That's right.
Made a mistake right here. That's not, I didn't get that, yeah. Right? That's what you've been taught. And so there is in the school that you want to be able to be self-sufficient in the knowledge of Yahshua the Messiah. Because mm-hmm. we know John 17:3, life eternal is to know. Know what? That's what you come down here to school to find out. Keep reading here.
For with stammering lips and another tongue will I speak to this people.
See, they're going to run you off on tongue and think they're going to do some wooga 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 booga 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 and chanting in tongues.
Yeah.
That's how they want to, many want to interpret
another tongue.
You with another tongue or a stammering lips. That's how they justify that. But we're not saying we're stammering, whereby you can't audibly and cognitively understand what we're talking about. You can understand what we're talking about. You may not understand how that blood got down here on these people. Needing to go to Ezekiel 33:4, but that picks up right away what Noah was doing and how that blood was not on Noah's hand and why he had to preach for 120 years to put the blood on their head. And then you're going to skip over here to the Ark of the brazen altar of sin sacrifice, right? And you're going to pick up another principle of blood. But that blood is the same thing as this blood. Because he went around the four corners of the earth. Remember, it was the Pangea. That whole Will talks about it. And we know about it through our history. Mm-hmm. That the earth was a Pangea, one land mass, right? So he went to the four corners of the earth, and that's the principle of this four on this altar. Because
right.
You got four points of blood that's on this altar. It's principles here. He put the blood on the door. 4 points. 2 side posts, struck it at the head post, and dipped from the basin. That's four. That's a principle.
Mm-hmm.
It don't change. You understand how the Messiah hung on the cross. You have struck in his hand, his feet. And you put the crown of thorns on his head. These are 4 points of blood. That's the principle or the precept that we're running the line on. And we skip around. We'll skip through the death. We'll skip through the water, which are immersion or baptism, whichever one to do you. But you got to understand the principles of that. And that's the foundation. That's the milk. That's the substance. Keep reading. Isaiah 28:9.
Right. 12. To whom he said, this is the rest wherewith ye may cause the weary to rest.
Sean picked up the yoke. I think it was Matthew, right? 11th chapter. The yoke. Take my yoke upon me and learn of me. That's what the Messiah said, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because his burden is light. When you understand what he's about. Because mm-hmm. he's the Savior of the world. He is Yahweh in a body saving our souls. If you understand what he's up and believe with all faith and due diligence. We read there, I believe with James, the last class,
yeah.
about that faith.
Right.
The faith of Abraham.
Mm-hmm.
And about that work.
Right.
Hey, that's a work to understand how these principles line up. That's what we're working with. And believing how we can see it all the way down to the scriptures and even within our own lives of how we were in steep or stygian black darkness, didn't know which way to go. And as it's been expressed, that the darkest place in the universe is within a man's consciousness. That's a beautiful statement.
Sure,
even Doc said when they were coming out here that, remember, that there was a plague of death, a plague of darkness. Stygian black darkness where you can't even see your hand. Sometimes in the fog, in your foggy day, you can't even see your hand. Imagine it just being dark and can't see. But yet realize that we think we're seeing colors and trees and beautiful sunsets and stuff, but you're still in darkness. People don't have an iota. People out down there at Myrtle Beach, 6 in the morning, waiting for this beautiful sunrise, because remember, we don't see the sunrise off the ocean. So that tripped me out too. It's an experience I had to wake up in the morning. Hey, babe, come look at the sun. It's coming, sun rising up over the ocean. I'm like, damn, I never even thought about that.
Yeah.
I see the sunrise. It's coming up over the mountains when I look east. But to be on the water's edge and see it come up over the water,
right?
Man, yeah. And that water line looks straight all the way across. Awesome. And it makes you think, people of time of old, they thought that the earth was flat. Because when you look out there, man, it looked like it's going to be a cliff out there. So you ponder those things and how the illusion or the imagination that Yahweh bestowed on the man, not knowing, and they set sail. Man, the confidence or the boldness of them to set sail in a wooden ship to just go yonder, Yahweh had to put it in mankind for us to have been able to amass the amount of information and knowledge that we have today to know that the world is a sphere that he stood on, right? Yeah. That they saw him stand on the sapphire. Sapphire is not flat. Sapphire is round. And so that's where it gives you a inkling to make the statement that the world's not flat. Keep reading there in Isaiah.
You may cause the weary to rest, and this is the refreshing. Mm-hmm. Yet they would not hear.
Yet they would not hear. That's the problem. They had received, many have received the refreshing, but yet they can't hear. Mm-hmm. Why not? Read.
But the word of Yahweh was unto them, precept upon precept.
Go back and read that again real quick.
To whom he said, mm-hmm. This is the rest wherewith ye may cause the weary to rest. Mm-hmm. And this is the refreshing, yet they would not hear.
They wouldn't hear it. Read.
But the word of Yahweh was unto them, mm-hmm. precept upon precept.
It was taught to them. These are the precepts that was taught to them or taught to us. Mm-hmm. You understand? And we heard it. Many have heard it, but they didn't believe it. Ah, that's just Bible stories. That's how they say it now. They don't even want to use the Bible. They don't want the textbook, right?
Oh, yeah.
That was just, that stuff out the backside, if you would. That's what's been stated. Mm-hmm. That's what it was stated when I went there and talked to them. It's dung. It ain't worth squat. That make me kind of shiver a little bit.
I know. Ooh. That's right.
How you going to say that when you've been given the precepts upon precepts, line upon line? You've been shown that, and now that ain't worth squat?
You got some nerve.
How you say that? But keep reading and see what happens when you think like that.
Precept upon precept. Mm-hmm.
They've been shown this, read.
Line upon line.
Uh-huh.
Line upon line.
Yep.
Here a little and there a little.
That's beautiful. That's the feed of them when they preach in the gospel. Here a little, there a little. Mm-hmm. Line upon line, precept upon precept. Death, burial, resurrection, ascension. 40. Read.
And there a little, that they might go and fall backward and be broken and snared and taken.
Taken by Elohim. Taken by the gospel of Yahshua Messiah. Be broken of your consciousness. Be broken of your egotistical, misdirected personality, of your thinking of how things are and what things are. I look out there. I'm not getting on a wooden ship and just setting sail across the Atlantic Ocean. Because I know it looks the same way looking back this way. I've never been to London or I've never been where they took off from to look back this way, I'm sure it looks like a dead, it looks like a cliff. Because they came to the Americas, right? So where they left from, England, to set sail this way, they ain't see America. They ain't see nothing other than the ocean mass. Hmm. So the spirit had to be in them to have the wherewithal to navigate Magellan and all them to do what they did. And that's Yahweh hadn't put it in. They didn't know.
Yeah. That's right.
But for us now to know why all that happened, we have this Daniel's chart to express. And we see how Saul and them traveled and coursed the known world of that time. And then they got down here in the England or the British, and they start selling sail from here. Because all that didn't, they, when America wasn't thought about.
Yeah.
They wasn't running over here to America thinking they're going to convert the Indians. It wasn't until, you know, this, I just said the British colony, because they say what, British colony had the most colony all over the world, whereby it was made the statement, the sun never set on the British Empire. Because they had their dominion in the antiquities in Jamaica and all over the known world, whereby that was a known ruler. Keep reading.
Wherefore, hear the word of Yahweh,
mm-hmm.
you scornful men
mm.
that rule this people which mm-hmm. is in Jerusalem.
Mm-hmm.
Because ye have said, we have made a covenant with death,
mm-hmm.
and with Sheol, are we at agreement?
You know what covenant that was? That Ten Commandment. That was a covenant. All that Yahweh say that he say we'll do, when he married them at the base of that Mount Sinai, on the June the 6th, they pledged their allegiance. Now, he's telling them they got to fall backwards of this. That's why he and be broken. What was broken? This Ten Commandment law that Moses brought down on the second trip. Then he broke it because we say what? This is symbolic of the first covenant that has to be broken. Mm-hmm. That's why Isaiah said, unless you fall backwards and be broken of your broken. Egotistical, misdirected personality. Keep reading.
When the overflowing scourge
mm-hmm.
shall pass through.
Mm-hmm.
It shall not come unto us, for we have made lies our refuge, and under falsehood have we hid ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore, thus saith Yahweh, behold, I lay in Zion for a foundation a stone,
mm-hmm.
a tri stone, a precious cornerstone,
mm-hmm.
a sure foundation.
That's Yahshua the Messiah.
Mm-hmm.
That's that stone he laid down there to get to find the stumbling stone for me in Hebrews. If you would, please. Keep reading, Eunice.
He that believeth shall not make haste.
Mm-hmm.
Judgment also will I lay to the line,
mm-hmm.
and righteousness to the plummet, and the hail shall sweep away.
Righteousness to the plummet. Plummet means a plumb line, means a straight line.
Straight line.
Hey, plummet, the way, the truth, the life. Believing in the righteousness of that plummet one, mm-hmm. right? Keep reading.
And the hail shall sweep away the refuge of lies,
mm-hmm.
and the water shall overflow the hiding place.
See, they're thinking they're going to hide. They're going to lie their way out of this. Because that's a lie to think that Dr. Kinley said, I'm the Savior. That's a lie. Understand mm-hmm. that? And there's multiple lies in various denominations. The Lord being your father is a lie. That's not true. And people hide in thinking, well, I know it's Yahweh, but I'm comfortable with the Lord. Jehovah's a name, and it's a 21st century name, where it's okay because it says it in the King James Bible. Do you know that? Did it say Jehovah in there?
Yeah.
Says it many a time. I just found one beautiful. Did you find that?
I think it's 1 Peter. What you want? 1 Peter 2:8. A stone of stumbling and a rock of offense.
Yeah. There's another one, though, Hebrews and Romans. You and Isaiah, right, Eunice?
Yes.
Go flip over to 26 and 4 real quick. Just so people know that that name of Jehovah is in there over 5 or 6 times.
Did you want me to get it out of the King James?
Mm-hmm.
Isaiah what?
26 and 4. Trust ye in the Lord forever, mm-hmm. for in the Lord, Jehovah, is everlasting strength.
They say it. They say Jehovah is everlasting strength. How can that be? They say the Lord, and now they say in Jehovah. They yeah. don't know how to put it together.
Yeah. So which one is he?
Now let's read it out of the holy name.
Trust.
You have a question? Mm-hmm.
Trust ye in Yahweh forever.
Trust ye in Yahweh forever. Read.
For Yahweh. Is the rock of ages.
Is the rock of ages. You got 7 ages. He is that rock. Don't be fooled. Yahshua in there too. Because he created Yahshua before ever the earth was. Yahshua had come down in the spirit. He was in the spirit of Adam. He was the spirit that told Noah. He was the spirit that told Abraham. By way of Melchizedek, which was a type and a shadow, but you're in a new age here. So there's a new thing happening when you get with Melchizedek here. But it's still Yahshua. It was Yahshua over here. Remember, it was Yahshua in this fourth dispensation that came in the form of Joshua. Known as Yahshua, 10 years after Noah left them after he fled out of Egypt. Then you have Joshua or Yahshua appearing down in Egypt. He lived for 120 years. Is that correct? 110. Joshua lived for 130, 40, and 40. 120 years. 30 in Egypt. He was 30 years old. Yeah. 40 years, that's 70.
Yeah.
And then another 40, 110, right? So Joshua lived to 110, and then he laid his life down. And then some 1,500 years later, you have Yahshua being born through the Virgin Mary appearing again. That's why he say in 1 Corinthians 15 chapter how that he rose again.
Right.
Well, when did he rise again? When did he take off the flesh? Or when did he die the first time in order to rise again? When Saul is talking about according to the scriptures, right. Well, you have Joshua or Yahshua according to the scriptures that Moses was writing about of him appearing at 30, tearing in the wilderness for 40 years and living in Canaan's land for 40 years. That's your 110. And he laid down his life. Grab that in Joshua, the 24th chapter. You have what you were finding there, Sean?
Yeah, the only place I could find what you're looking for is in 1 Peter 2:2-6.
Okay, go ahead.
Read that?
Mm-hmm.
All right. Wherefore also it is contained in the scripture, behold, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone, elect, precious.
That's it. That's what Isaiah was just talking about, that stump, that rock of offense, right?
Right.
There in Isaiah 28, you're talking about that rock of offense, Reed.
And he that believeth on him shall not be confounded.
Not believe on the rock, but believe on him. Him was the one that came. Him was the one that was the first begotten in order to save the world. He was that rock that went with the children of Israel to and through the Red Sea. Mm-hmm. Christianity got him pegged as the rock in the margins. Keep reading.
Unto you, therefore, which believe, he is precious.
He's precious. Hey, keep reading.
But unto them which be disobedient.
Which be disobedient. How are you disobedient when you think you're going to be progressive and go beyond or regress back or think that this ain't nothing? Mm-hmm. That's disobedience. What happens?
the stone which the builders rejected.
Mm-hmm. They reject this information right now, right? They don't want to acknowledge this information. They don't want to share this information for the world. They want to keep it reclused. They want to quarantine it. They don't want to share it with nobody. They want to keep it for themselves. Because you didn't know who Dr. Kinley was, then you can't know this information. What? Keep reading.
The same is made the head of the corner.
Yep. Isaiah had already prophesied this. We're just reading out of the 2 Peter or 1 Peter about this rock of offense. Keep reading.
And a stone of stumbling,
mm-hmm.
and a rock of offense,
mm-hmm.
even to them which stumble at the word.
The word ain't the Bible. The word's not the scriptures. The word.
It's the truth.
It's Elohim. Mm-hmm. The word is Elohim. Read.
Even to them which stumble at the word, mm-hmm. being disobedient, whereunto also they were appointed.
Oh, they were appointed. Certain ones know how to run the charts. They don't want to adhere to it. They want to go off on their own merry way, according to their carnality, and not share, as it's expressed in Matthew, the 24th chapter, go ye therefore and preach the gospel unto all the world, as a witness and for them. Hey, Noah did it.
Sure did.
He did it for 120 years. We ain't even done it since Dr. Kennedy left in 1976. It ain't been that long. Mm-mm. And we already ready to jump off the pot and say that this is for naught. Mm-hmm. Or this is old information. Mm-hmm. Barely understand, barely can remember how to line things up. Let alone help someone else understand how it works, whereby you can be blessed of like unto his son. Mm-hmm. For Moses speaking for 120 years saved his soul. But see, you have to believe that this ark that was sanctioned by Yahweh to Noah to build, being threefold, an upper deck, a middle deck, and a lower deck, with a window and a door, that has to mean something to us. Mm-hmm. It ain't just a boat, as one of the speakers spoke about at this gathering. Mm-hmm. Beautiful lecture on people thinking that this was just a boat. And if your idea thinking that this was just Noah and the boat and some people got in a boat and it has no reverence to you, why a people? Why his family, and only Noah's family, that got in the boat. His wife, his three kids, and their wives. They weren't Noah's wives or daughters. They were other people that they married in or were grafted in unto his family. As we've been shown, because of this promise back here, Abraham, something was going to happen back here too. That seed, which was Yahshua, which is going to be for the people, and when he died, buried, and resurrected, did he resurrect alone and by himself? He resurrected first, mm-hmm. and then the sons of them that were back here, speaking of the fathers that believed and had faith, also rose with him, mm-hmm. right? And so that's the gathering that we're all being gathered in now in this age, because after the death, burial, and resurrection, and outpouring of the Holy Spirit, this age ended, whereby ushered in a fourth age, ushered in the fifth dispensation, where we're reading about with Saul and Peter and whatnot, the epistles that were the first to have received the Pentecost. 7 years later, the Gentiles, and we say unto this day, that outpouring is still being resonated unto the minds and hearts to those men and women that believe the report. In this sixth dispensation, whereby Dr. Kinley, your boy, had came in and had received the Holy Spirit, did do that, was the seventh angel, according to the scriptures, whereby he was able to usher in the truth about what Moses saw in his third age, where he dwelled in the fourth dispensation, and John being a witness, an eyewitness until Yahshua Messiah in the fourth dispensation, watched his death on the cross at Calvary, and then was able to receive Pentecost 50 days after the ascension of Yahshua the Messiah, right? Because remember, 40 days after he rose, he tarried on earth for 40 days.
Right.
And then when he ascended up into heaven, he's tarried there for 10 days.
Right.
And that's your 50. And the June 6th, the ushering out the Holy, or the Pentecost of the Holy Spirit unto John and the other 120 that were in the upper room, whereby John now has a revelation about what he had transpired, because he had the understanding of the Holy Spirit in him in order to write. That's why Moses wrote five books. How many books did John write?
Five.
Gotta know, he got to wrote five. John, 1 John, 2 John, 3 John, and the book of Revelations. Hey, that's five and five. That's complete. That's 10. Understand? And so now you got Dr. Kennedy coming in the sixth dispensation, confirming and reaffirming what Moses saw in his first five books, and letting us be known what Revelation was all about.
Preach.
According to the scriptures, right? Therefore, it gives us some confidence in blood, water, spirit, 40, because that's who taught us.
Mm-hmm.
And it's good enough to this day
sure
to
is.
Preach anybody off the floor anywhere, because it's been done. And it's going to continue to be done until the universal revelation of Yahshua the Messiah. 2 Thessalonians 1. I don't have anything holding, do I? Because we read Proverbs, we got Jehovah, right?
Mm-hmm.
You see how they use a name.
There was a little bit left in 1 Peter.
Let's go ahead and pick up that little bit. We got time.
Ninth verse. But ye are a chosen generation.
That's the people that believe in the report. Read.
A royal priesthood.
That's what Peter talking about. They royalty.
A holy nation.
Holy. People claim to be holy and highly favored and truly blessed. How? How are you that?
Really?
Don't let me get to talking about people that way.
Really?
I refrain my tongue until I understand more clearly. But nonetheless, keep reading.
A peculiar people.
Yes, we are.
That's right.
Yes, we're indeed peculiar.
That ye should show forth the praises of him who hath called you out of the darkness into his marvelous light.
Out of this darkness, a Stygian black darkness of not knowing who your creator is. Understanding what metaphysical means, meaning beyond the flesh, as Sean talked about it on Tuesday. Understanding how that understanding will elevate you in your consciousness. It ain't going to take you nowhere. Can't go nowhere beautiful. Dayton House is where we stayed, so I keep calling it a Daytona.
Okay.
Myrtle Beach was beautiful, but that's not heaven. That water was not heaven, the Atlantic Ocean I'm speaking of.
Mm-hmm.
It was vast. It was pretty in the picture, but getting up close and personal to it, there's some problems. I'd rather run back over to Hawaii. If you're going to ask me to pick some water, I'm not going there.
Yeah.
Without a doubt.
Yeah.
There's a complete difference from Hawaii water, ocean water, to that water. And there's a difference between Huntington Beach water and Laguna Beach water and Darkwater Beach water here in California than Hawaii water.
Yeah.
there's a distinct difference. Now I've been in all three. There's a complete difference. An island unto itself, that location is different than this landmass that we live on, either the east or west coast now. It's not the same. Keep reading.
Which in times past were not a people, but are now the people of Yahweh.
See, that's that heavenly Jerusalem from above, whereby we're thinking about Yahshua in an elevated state, not progressive, but elevated state in understanding what it was all for and seeing how this takes our picture in order to put us on this chart to whereby we're now from heaven above. Keep reading.
Which had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy.
That's it? Keep on going, what did it say?
Dearly beloved, I beseech you as strangers and pilgrims, abstain from fleshly lusts which war against the soul.
Abstain from them thoughts that come into our souls or our spirit that we've been directed against or shown according to the scriptures, what we say according to our misdirected personality. And there's something I want to get to. Hopefully I'll get to it. About those thoughts, about those lusts I want to bring out. Keep reading. I like that.
Having your conduct honest among the heathen, that whereas they speak against you as evildoers, they may by your good works, which ye shall behold, glorify Yahweh in the day of visitation.
Hey, that visitation visiting us now in the gospel of Yahshua Messiah. That gives us direction left or right. Hearing Yahshua telling us to move and how to move. We have to believe in what has been presented to us, correct? We have to believe in a Moses and a John because he writes about them, the prophets. We have to believe in some fashion, right? But then we also have to believe that that takes our picture. That's what's been shown on this chart. But then when does he speak to us within our consciousness to know the difference between right and wrong? We see it expressed in the gospel. We have Jonas. Jonas didn't want to go to Nineveh. Right. And we can read about Jonas' disobedience, if you would, and trying to get on a ship to sail away from his responsibility. We have a responsibility as ambassadors of Yahshua Messiah to preach the gospel.
Right.
Therefore, we have to hear and know what thus saith Yahweh. Not just reading it on the book, but take it off the book and put it on ourselves to listen and to know right from wrong. That's what the people are going to be able to discern and call us a peculiar people, because we're going to be going left when everybody else is going right. When we have the true faith and confidence in Yahshua Messiah in us, we say that Yahshua be in you. How are he in you? Because you can hear him. You can see him. Just like you see him operating and functioning with the children of Israel with this migratory pattern. We say this is a greater and more perfect tabernacle, or is the universe. Well, we ain't nothing outside of Yahweh, right? According to this fiery cloud, according to our oxygen in the ozone layer, we can't get outside and look back at Yahweh. So therefore, we got to be in Yahweh and Yahweh in us and know according to a pattern that we've been shown and believe in that within us so that we can tarry on earth until what the visitation you just read. That's what it said?
Yep. You want me to read it again?
Yeah, just read it again.
Having your conduct honest among the heathen. That whereas they speak against you as evildoers.
That's how we say. They say we evildoers that believe in Yahweh. We evildoers and say that this is not a Trinity. They're evil. That's evil doing to them in their consciousness. Keep reading.
They may by your good works, which they shall behold.
Yeah, they're going to see it. They're going to see it. They're going to hear it. Keep reading.
Glorify Yahweh in the day of visitation.
Hallelujah. All praises to Yahweh. Then you ask a person next time they say hallelujah and ask them what they mean. I've done it a couple of times. They don't know. And they spell it hallelujah. They put a J-A-H. Look it up in the dictionary. You can ask Google. They put a J-A-H in there thinking that they're saying something. They know not Yahweh. They do not know the purpose of what they breathe day in and day out since they were a child when they took that first inspiration of breath. As a child does when they come out of that womb, crying unto the Father. That's why children say, Dada first. Because it's unto the Father that all praises and glory must go to. That's only a type and a shadow that children do that. And it's a beautiful thing to recognize that fact. Keep reading.
Submit yourselves to every ordinance of man for Yahweh's sake.
Yes.
Whether it be to the king as supreme or unto governors as unto them that are sent by him for the punishment of evildoers and for the praise of them that do well. For so is the will of Yahweh.
Yes.
that with well doing,
yes,
ye may put to silence the ignorance of foolish men.
Didn't we call this darkness ignorance? Don't we want to end out what ministers do? Is it teach the erroneous doctrine of Yahshua the Messiah? Because that's all everybody got that Bible, and most denominations are going to spin off whatever they're spinning off of that Bible. So therefore, to right the wrong that they've interpreted, this is our duty to do so as teachers,
right,
is to right the wrong, in other words. Mm-hmm. All the denominations, how big and mighty they might be, they got tens of thousands in their hall preaching to J.D. Jakes and Joel Osteen. That don't scare me, iota. I'd not scare you, and especially if they come in onesie-twosies. Because we have to believe in the report that we've been shown and given, and allow Yahweh to speak through us as he does a jackass, and as he allows us to speak according to the principles of blood, water, spirit, 40, because it will take off and your feet will start dancing and preaching the gospel as it says that you were being taught. Keep reading.
As free,
mm-hmm,
and not using your liberty for a cloak of maliciousness.
No righteousness. That's the egotistical personality. Using that cloak for your righteousness to think you're going to harbor away something. It has there's a reading back there with David or Joshua. That one, I think Samuel would know it. Eleazar. That wasn't Eleazar. A-Z-I. That took that little stone, huh?
Aholiab.
It was Aholiab. Doing a Yahweh say, destroy everything. Don't take nothing of the heathens. He takes some Jews and stuck it in his way.
Right.
Took it back to his tent. Think he gonna keep the little treasure for himself.
Yep.
And then Joshua found out, hey, we losing, guys. He hearing Yahweh in his conscience. Hey, someone done took something. Mm-hmm. Everybody lined up. Had them lined up. What did you call them, Eunice?
Holy Ab.
So it was an A. I know Holy Ab, right?
Yep.
Well, then he come up. Man, put this shit on them. Mm-hmm. For Yahweh, Joshua. I took it. Joshua killed him and his whole family. And so I say this family that got in this ark, that's an important thing. Family is an important thing. And this family that we're teaching that's coming into the sounds and the utterance of the true gospel is family. According to a spiritual understanding. That's why flesh and blood family don't mean dilly squat to me in that fashion.
Yep.
I hope and love, but there'll come a time, hey, It's not my prerogative, because you have to listen to the Spirit above. That's that Holy Spirit that's already been ushered out that we have to learn to listen to without bar. Keep reading. There's more there.
But as the servants of Yahweh.
You're a servant of Yahweh and got nothing to do with family. Physical, literal family I'm speaking of. Because this was a physical literal family as a type and a shadow that they only ate that hurt out of all the world that got on that ark. And you have to understand that this ark ain't a boat. This ark is a type and a shadow of this ark of Yahshua the Messiah.
Right.
That needs to be understood. Hey, threefold was one thing structure that was told to Noah to build. Threefold was this tabernacle that was shown and told Moses to build, and threefold was this temple.
Right.
And these are the only three structures that were threefold, and threefold. One ark, one tabernacle, one temple.
Right.
And if I believe 1 John 5:7 says there's three
that bear record
in heaven. The Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit. And these three are one. This ark is Yahshua. This tabernacle was the ark that Elohim, Yahweh Elohim, said that he was going to dwell in the midst of them within. You had that cloud that come down into this ark and filled up all the ark, or all the tabernacle, as it were. That was his dwelling place. Same thing with this temple up here. And this dome, like into a brightness, witness into a man sitting on his throne. This is the purposes by which these three structures, not your church, not your gazebo, not your Ephesus, it's what Yahshua said build, and these are only three things. And whereby he's going to build it or write it in our hearts and mind, this spirit law, whereby we're the tabernacle that Sean's talking about. Keep reading.
Honor all men.
Yeah.
Love the brotherhood.
Hey, love is the greatest commandment, second greatest commandment. The first greatest commandment is to love Yahweh with all your heart and with all your might. The second is to love your brother. You can't just love every old body. That's just a fact. Friends, family, or foe, unless they have the spirit of Yahshua in them. Read.
Fear Yahweh.
Ah, yes. There is a fear of Yahweh. And to what?
Honor the king.
Honor the king. Read.
Servants, be subject to your masters with all fear.
That's good enough. Okay. Great. Servants, be subject to your master with all fear. Read.
Not only to the good and the gentle, yes, but also to the froward.
Okay.
For this is thankworthy. If a man for conscience toward Yahweh endure grief, suffering wrongfully, for what glory is it if, when ye be buffeted for your faults, ye shall take it patiently?
That's what Stephen did. That's what Stephen did. Buffeted for his, for those who stoned him. Read.
But if, when ye do well and suffer for it, ye take it patiently, this is acceptable with Yahweh.
That's those are things acceptable to Yahweh. You had a question, Bud, or a statement?
Yeah, well, I'd like you to explain. If I heard you correctly, you said the ark was Yahshua. Or did I misunderstand you?
No, I said that. This ark is a depiction of Yahshua. I did say that, yes. How?
Yeah, I'm having a problem saying the boat is the Holy Spirit.
Okay, that's good. Fine question. grab me Genesis. I think it's 6, 7, and 7.
Genesis.
We agree that Yahweh told man to build only three things.
Right.
Correct?
Right.
I'm gonna need also the tabernacle. Gonna dwell in the tabernacle. Genesis 7 and 7. Mike can start at 5 or so.
Genesis 7 and 5. And Noah did according unto all that Yahweh commanded him. And Noah was 600 years old when the flood of waters was upon the earth.
Yahshua told Noah, Yahweh Elohim told Noah to build this ark when he was 480 years old, because then he spoke for 120 years old, and that's when he got to 600 that she's reading about right here, when he's 600 years old. Read.
And Noah did according as all that Yahweh commanded him, and Noah was 600 years old when the flood of waters was upon the earth. And Noah went in, and his sons and his wife and his sons' wives with him into the ark.
That's true, correct? They had to go into the ark. And he had to go in the ark. This was the ark of safety.
Right.
From this impending flood.
Right.
Now I'm going to catch another one. They were down here at the Passover. Remember, we're dealing with types, shadows, and allegories, and metaphors, and similes. And what I'm using, this is an ark of safety for those eight souls that she just stated went into this ark. And they had to be in it, correct? Down here with the children of Israel, there were some things going on down here. And there was a death decree coming that was down here in Egypt, correct? And Yahweh in the 12th chapter of Exodus going to tell Aaron and Moses what to do to flee this impending doom. Mm-hmm. Impending doom was coming here too, right? Yeah. Impending doom was coming here too, right? Mm-hmm. With the death angel. That's why you have the Passover. Mm-hmm. Now, what did they have to do with down here in Egypt? They had to take out a lamb, correct? Without spot and blemish. First of the yearling. Had to drain it, kosher style, drain the blood. Can't break no bones. I mean, you just can't start cutting arteries. You had to pierce it and draw that blood out. That's where you get kosher from, correct? And so now they had to prepare this lamb and roast it. What else they have? Bitter herbs and unleavened bread. Three. One, two, three. Upper deck, middle deck, lower deck. Three things. What do they have to do?
Let me read it. Exodus 12 and 5.
If you read it, it's even better.
Your lamb shall be without blemish.
Yeah.
A male of the first year.
Yeah.
Ye shall take it out of the sheep or from the goats. And ye shall keep it up until the 14th day of the mm-hmm. same month. Mm-hmm. And the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it between the two evenings. Mm-hmm. And they shall take up the blood and strike it on the two side posts and on the upper door posts of the house wherein they shall eat it.
Mm-hmm.
And they shall eat the flesh in the night, roast with fire and unleavened bread.
They had to eat it. What was this lamb indicative of?
The Yahshua.
This lamb is indicative of Yahshua, right? Okay. Say, okay, are we sure? We're going to have to understand that. Yeah. John says, behold, the Lamb of Yahweh cometh, that's taken away the sins of the world. I think that's Matthew 3. Mm-hmm. Okay? This lamb, without spot and blemish, wasn't he without spot and blemish? When Pontius Pilate looked him over
right.
and said, hey, I don't see no fault with him. Right. That's the same thing he just read about this lamb. This is how we're correlating this Passover lamb with this Passover lamb. Didn't they kill him on the Passover mm-hmm. and hold him over? They had to get him off the cross. They ate, remember, he ate down the last Passover with the disciples, correct? Mm-hmm. In the house mm-hmm. alone. And that event is because of this first event. And so you have this lamb being likened to Yahshua the Messiah. And they had to eat that lamb, meaning they had to digest that lamb. That's the supping that we're doing now with these charts. Why? Because we're learning about Yahshua the Messiah. We're not eating a lamb with roasted herbs and unleavened bread. That's what they had to do. Our roasting, our unleavened, our lamb is the righteousness of the gospel that we're eating in order to what? To preserve us for the universal revelation of Yahshua the Messiah. So this is a type of ingesting this lamb as we're ingesting this gospel. Them having to eat, go down there and say he had to eat all of it.
Yes. And ye shall, Exodus 12 and 10.
Exodus 12 and 10.
And ye shall let nothing of it remain until the morning, and that which remaineth of it until the morning ye shall burn with fire.
You have to burn that which you can eat, and after you give it to your neighbor, all that you can give, eat as much of the lamb as you can. You have to digest that. It had to go in you, just like they had to go in the ark mm-hmm. for their salvation. They had to eat all of that lamb in them so that they can be saved from this death angel that was impending, just like this flood that was going to be impending upon all the world. This event happened because Egypt was the known world at that time. And it was going to be coming down by the great hand of Yahweh. Mm-hmm. Noah and Aaron, Moses and Aaron knew about that. And everybody who didn't do this, what happened? The firstborn of every man and beast got.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
They died. Yep.
They died. And they had to do this and continue on after the 14th day. And when they, from the 16th day, they had to go to and through this Red Sea. Are we following me now? Why I'm correlating this this ark is a threefold structure that was told them to do. This event, it was a this was an event that they were told to do for safety. This tabernacle was a tabernacle where Elohim dwelt with the children of Israel, correct? As this cloud. Because he would come in, the cloud would fill this. And what did they do? They had to follow that cloud for 40 years, right? Yep. A pillory fire by night and a cloud by day. That's what they followed. That was their safety.
Right.
If you touch this ark, people died, right?
Right.
So Yahweh Elohim is not playing. But we know there's a unity. So whether I say Yahweh Elohim or Yahshua, I'm speaking about the unity of the Spirit. Yahshua down here with them, told them to get this lamb out.
Right.
Yahweh here was telling them to move, get into this ark on a particular day.
Right.
And that spirit is going to shut the ark. This is the ark of Yahweh. And this is the safety that these eight souls were able to sustain themselves until they were able to come over on this side of the ark and land between this Mount Ararat, right? On this mountain, whereby Yahweh made another covenant with Noah, that he's not going to destroy the world again by flood. Because why? They were in the ark. We're supposed to be in the spirit or in the knowledge of Yahweh Elohim. Because it says to know Yahshua, the Messiah, is our salvation. Right? So this is a type of knowing. Threefold structure. This is a type of knowing, of having that lamb, which is indicative of Yahshua Messiah, be in you. Skip that. Grab me 14, Exodus 14. This is right good. Stand still and watch the salvation.
14:13.
Now look it. We're down here in Egypt. And this Passover, in order to get through this plague of the death angel that was impending upon the people, correct? And this darkness, and they had to escape, go up a little bit from there. And you had them having to put their kneading boards on their back, correct? And because they're going to be taking a journey up out of Egypt by the great hand of Yahweh. But look what happens when they're getting ready to get out here at this Red Sea.
Okay, 11.
Okay.
And they said unto Moses, because there were no
they grapes. They said unto Moses, who ate the lamb. They ate the lamb. They had the lamb in them. They survived the death angel. Follow? They took in the information. But do they believe the information? Do they understand the information? This is why. Keep reading.
Because there were no grapes in Egypt. Has thou taken us away to die in the wilderness?
That's what they said to Moses. There's no graves. What are we going to do out here? Read.
Wherefore hast thou dealt thus with us to carry us forth out of Egypt?
Why'd you sit us down and teach us all this stuff? What does it matter what name you use? Read.
Is not this the word that we did tell thee in Egypt, saying, let us alone, that we may serve the Egyptians.
You serve whatever idol. Serve my egotistical, misdirected personality. They don't know what's going on. They ain't been shown nothing. They ate this lamb, though. They have something in them. Read.
For it has been better for us to serve the Egyptians than that we should die in the wilderness.
It's been better I ain't even learned all of this stuff. It better be me better. I never came across the name of Yah. That's how some people think. Because they don't believe. They don't understand. They don't can't correlate it. They can't see the principles. Keep reading.
And Moses said unto the people.
Moses said this.
Fear ye not.
Fear not.
Stand
don't
still.
Fear not. Don't look. Hey, you got 600 chariots, 600 horsemen, and 600 horses. That's your 666. That's a type and a shadow of Satan or Pharaoh and his host pursuing them. They're at this Red Sea. That's why they're saying it had been better if we just stayed in Egypt. Mm-hmm. He said, but don't fear. Yahweh is telling Moses to tell them, don't fear what you've been taught, what you ate. Keep reading.
Fear not. Stand still.
Stand still in your consciousness about what you think is coming, what's pending. There's pending doom here. There's pending doom coming. There's pending doom yet to fall upon us. But stand still in your consciousness about what you've been taught about blood, water, spirit, 40. 1, 2, 3. The ark, the tabernacle, the temple. Believe in these things. Keep reading.
And see the salvation of Yahweh.
And see the salvation of Yahweh that delivered them here, that delivered the 8 souls here, because they believed the report of Noah that spoke for 120 years. Hey, they believed it here. They followed the tabernacle for 40 years. And those that believed in Yahshua the Messiah that hung on the cross, they believed in him until Pentecost came 50 days after the death, burial, and resurrection of Yahshua the Messiah. They believed the report. Hey, didn't Cornelius at Cornelius' house, a Gentile, believe? They had to believe the report. They had to believe. They were in the Spirit. This was the Holy Spirit that came into men. Hey, I'm just reversing it and saying, this is the tabernacle or the ark that was Yahshua Messiah. It was their safety that those men went in. And it was Yahshua that protected them, or the ark that protected them. I'm talking about spiritual things. Right. This is the things from up above. Keep reading.
Which he will show to you today.
Yahshua is going to reveal these things unto you the day that you need to know those things. This is what we want to reveal unto the people. Anything else there? I'll be right done. I heard the bell.
For the Egyptian whom ye have seen today.
What they have seen down here today, or what they had all experienced, what they were building this ark and people were calling Noah and his people foolish. Remember, they were 7 days up in here and they hadn't rained. They were calling them foolish. They were in the ark of Yahshua, or the ark, whatever want to do you. But you have to be in Yahshua the Messiah, and he be in you, correct? Read.
Ye shall see them again no more, forever.
Forever. If you have Yahshua be in you. If you got anything out of tonight's class, all praises to Yahweh our Elohim by way of Yahshua the Messiah. Let us all say hallelujah. Hallelujah. That's it.
Great job.
Good question, brother.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Love. That will conclude this evening's lecture. And we don't have any announcements. Besides, we still have our cards out there. We will continue to leave them out there until Sunday for Dr. Marion Harris's family and for Dr. Oliver Gill's family as well. So if you haven't had an opportunity to sign those, you still do have an opportunity up until the end of day on Sunday. We hold classes here at 1816 East Elma Court in Ontario, California on Tuesdays and Thursdays from 7:30 p.m. to 9:30 p.m. and on Sundays from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. Please bring all your friends and all your enemies, because this is truly the place to learn something truthful about your Heavenly Father, Yahweh. Let us all stand to be dismissed with the doxology taken from the last two verses of Jude. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all time, now and ever. Let us all say, hallelujah. Hallelujah.